Good evening, NAACP family, and everyone tuning in to our virtual discussion on bail bonds tonight. We'd like to start off by giving a big thank you to the NAACP, the Mystic Valley NAACP branch, and the NAACP NextGen Fellows who organized tonight's event. This would not have been possible without the collective effort and hard work of many people. We thank you. My name is Anthony Hendrix, and I'm a proud member of NAACP's Next Generation Fellowship and your moderator for tonight's discussion. We're excited that you're joining us, and we have a great conversation in store guided by some exceptional leaders. I'm really excited to introduce everybody to them. Before we begin, I want a better idea of where our participants. So our audience is actually joining us from. So right now, if you can, there should be a chat feature at the bottom of your Zoom window. If you could, in that Zoom window, just add right now, which city are you tuning into our discussion from tonight? So for me, I'll start us off. I'm tuning in from Chicago, Illinois. I'm a part of the West Side chapter here. Let's go. I'm seeing the chat already light up. We got Boston. Hello, hello. Come on, let's go. Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Ann Arbor, Michigan. Welcome, welcome. Houston, Texas. Oh, this is great. We've got Detroit on the call. I'm so excited to see so many different individuals representing different cities and different perspectives. This is really going to pay off whenever we start discussing bail reform tonight, just to have everybody's thoughts and opinions. So thank you so much for tuning in. Let me make something clear tonight before we introduce our panelists. Whether bail reform is a new topic for you, or if you've been an advocate for bail reform for quite some time now, we hope that everybody by the end of this discussion can take something away tonight. And at this time, I will tell you, speaking of our discussion, it is my true privilege order to introduce you all to our panelists. I had the chance to chat with them a little bit before, but I'm really excited to officially introduce them. So we would like to officially start with Asia Johnson. Asia's on the call tonight, and she refers to herself as a bail disruptor. I love it. It's a title that she's proud of, and in her work with the Bail Project, a national nonprofit working towards ending mass incarceration, Asia has helped a lot of people who have not been convicted of crimes to get released from Wayne County Jail in Detroit. Asia, can you give us a wave? Thank you so much for being here tonight. We also have on the call this evening, providing expertise and knowledge, Eli Savit. Eli is a former law clerk to the late and great Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and he currently serves as the City of Detroit's senior legal counsel, where he leads criminal justice reform work for Michigan's largest city. Eli's also a nationally recognized attorney who's led public interest lawsuits against some of the country's toughest adversaries, such as banks, the opioid industry, slumlords, and corporate polluters. Wow, Eli, what a pleasure. Thank you so much for being here with us. And then last but not least, we have Atara Rich-Shea. Atara is the Immigration Bond Coordinator with the National Bail Fund Network and previously did faith-based justice work and youth organizing. She is a Unitarian Universalist minister and part of the founding, I see you, so I'm going to give you the chance to correct me, Atara, I see you over there, and part of the founding team of the Beyond Bond Fund in Boston. Atara, I'll give you the space to actually correct anything that I said that was incorrect. I saw you shaking your head. You're good? Okay, great. Thank you all so much to our panelists for being here. It is a true pleasure to have you on this call this evening. So before we start, let's actually just kind of talk about what the stage of tonight's discussion is going to look like. So what is going to happen is that we have prepared questions which have already been shared with our panelists in advance. So our experts are going to have about 45 minutes to share their responses before we transition into a 15-minute question and answer or a little Q&A session at the end of this call. I have two asks of you. Number one is that as our panelists are sharing their thoughts on the questions that they've already prepared, I'm encouraging anybody who's out there in the chat feature to light it up. Share with us your own thoughts or ideas. What I really like to do is whenever I'm a part of discussions like this and I hear something really great, I call that a gem. So if you hear a sentence or a phrase or someone says something that just really speaks to you, let everyone know that by sharing that in the chat. chat. My second request is that everybody hold your questions until the end. I'm sure that even for myself, while we're going to be talking tonight, we'll be like, oh my gosh, I want to interrupt, you know, Asia or Eli or Atara in order to ask a question. But please hold on to those questions. And in the last 15 minutes, we will provide the entire space and time for you to be able to ask any questions that you would like to our moderators. Well, with that being said, as you can tell, I'm clearly excited to moderate tonight, but I'm even more excited to just be a listener and a learner. So let's dive right in. Asia, I'd like to start with you, and then the rest of our panelists, Atara and Eli, you can jump in whenever you would like to. Asia, the first question I'd like us to start off with today is, can you tell us a little bit more about yourself and what initially got you involved in bail reform? I'll unmute you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Hi, everybody. My name is Asia. Up until a couple weeks ago, I was a bail disruptor for the Bail Project. I am now the communications associate for the Bail Project, and we are a national nonprofit that serves over 20 communities across the country. We post bail for people who cannot afford to post it for themselves. I think I got started in this work years and years ago. The gem, as you called it, Anthony, that resonated with me is I was actually incarcerated in the Wayne County Jail, and I had a bunkie or a roommate that was in for $200. She could not go home because she didn't have the $200 that it would take to get her freedom. And at that time, I had never been incarcerated before. I was really young, and I just couldn't fathom not having $200 or not having a family member have $200. And she stayed for about 6 weeks in the jail until she actually went to court and got her charges dismissed. And so she really stuck with me because that's when the criminalization of poverty really took hold of me, and I thought, this is ridiculous. I can't believe people are sitting in jail because they're poor. And then later on, I read an article about Khalif Browder, and that story changed my entire life. I know what it's like to be traumatized by the carceral state, and that trauma can lead you to taking your own life if you don't have the support or the help or wishing that that experience had never taken place at all. And so when I came home from prison 2 years ago, I knew that I wanted to get in this work. I knew that bail reform was something that had to happen. And my best friend, actually, we had several conversations about Khalif Browder and about the cash bail system, and she was doing great work. And she sent me the link for the Bail Project for their career site. And I didn't think I was going to get hired. I was fresh home from spending 9 years away from my family and friends and from the world. And so when I got the job, I was so excited, not for my own selfish, like, oh, now I can pay my bills. Oh, now I can be independent. But because now I can help people who were once sitting in the spot that I was sitting in.
Wow. That is incredibly powerful, Asia. Thank you so much for sharing that with us, that personal story as well. Thank you. Eli, would you like to jump in next? Just interested in what actually brought you to bail reform.
Yeah, sure. So you know, I would say that I have a little bit different perspective. And you mentioned sort of my legal career, but I actually started my career as an eighth grade U.S. history teacher. Even before I was in law school. And when I was a teacher, I had kids and I had families who were impacted by the criminal justice system, you know, including folks being held pretrial before they'd been convicted of anything on cash bail. You know, when I was working on the Supreme Court, I remember, you know, the flood of petitions we would get from folks that were in prisons, folks that had been sentenced. And the truth of the matter is there was not much the Supreme Court could do because everything that was done to them was entirely legal. And Asia mentioned Khalif Browder, but I remember, you know, I was riding the bus to work one day at the Supreme Court, and I was reading an article about Khalif Browder in the New Yorker. I think the article that really sort of catapulted his story to the nation. And it just struck me that we are doing so much in the justice system that is technically legal, right? But functionally is at odds with our presumption of innocence in this country and with the fundamental notion that we don't have debtors' prisons, that we don't have a system in which we are holding people in jail simply because they are poor. I've seen this through my work at the city of Detroit. I served as the city's liaison to a statewide joint task force on jail and pretrial incarceration for the city. And I decided actually to run for prosecutor in my home county, precisely because I wanted to reform the criminal justice system. And one of my major campaign platforms was we need to end cash bail. And I'm an absolutist on this. I'm not somebody that thinks like, well, bail in cases of serious crimes and whatever. No, I just think your wealth should have absolutely no bearing on whether you are held in jail or ever. But just think about it, especially because we are talking about people who have not been convicted of anything yet. They are sitting in jail because A, they are poor, and B, they have been accused of a crime, not convicted. It is on an accusation, and it is because of poverty. And so that's how I got into this work.
Wow. No cash bail, period. I hear you on that one, Eli. We're definitely going to dig into that some more, but I want to give Atara the space to be able to share out. Atara, what brought you into the work of bail reform?
So I first wanted to correct my bio. While you read
Please
a
do.
Very good bio, it's not me. You read the bio of a colleague of mine who is a reverend, a Unitarian minister. I am not that.
Got it. Okay.
So a little bit about me then. I work for two organizations. So I work for the National Bail Fund Network, which is an organization of 88 bail and bond funds around the country in the immigration and criminal context. I'm a regional organizer, so I provide technical and administrative support to bail funds who are up and coming and who are sort of coming into their own as ongoing bail and bond funds. And I assist with larger campaigns to end pretrial detention. I'm also the executive director of the Massachusetts Bail Fund. So the Massachusetts Bail Fund has been around since 2013. We post and have posted bails throughout Massachusetts. And I manage the daily operations and the larger ongoing projects towards ending the system of pretrial incarceration and supervision in Massachusetts, which is very different from my colleague, Elizabeth, who runs the immigration side of things. I previously was a public defender, so I worked in the Massachusetts Public Defender's Office for quite some time in the district and the Superior Court. So I came to this work through making bail arguments, right? Like through having clients in front of me, having people in front of me, having people I loved in front of me, where you have to make an argument that they should be able to go home instead of going to jail while awaiting their trial. And I noticed a couple of things. I noticed the race differential between my clients who were incarcerated pretrial and my clients who weren't. And I noticed how differently they got treated. And the overarching conclusion I came to is that the purpose of bail, while the legal purpose of bail is one thing, like Eli said, we're doing all of this legally, the actual purpose in practice is to keep people in jail. And bail is used for one and maybe two things. It's used to keep people in jail and it's used to force pleas. People will agree to pretty much anything in order to get out of jail. And one of my very first experiences with this was as a very, very new public defender, very long time ago, where you get your clients on the day, you meet them, they're all in lockup, they're all wearing the clothes that they were wearing when they were arrested. If it's a Monday, it's from Friday in Massachusetts. Okay. And at the same time, there was a raid, there was a party raid at a university. And all of those white people walked in through the front door. They were all given diversion. They were all, none of them were prosecuted. They were all led to go home that day. And all of my clients that day, who were largely young black men, had bails put on them and weren't allowed to go home that day. And that was sort of my first understanding as a very young lawyer of how predictive bail was in terms of how a case goes. So I've been doing this work for a really long time now. I've been running the bail fund since 2013. And we've posted bail for almost 4,000 people. We've spent over $2 million doing it. And we've learned a couple of things along the way. So I hope we'll be able to talk about that.
Definitely. Atara, thanks so much for correcting me. My apologies. And actually, Atara, you brought up a really good point that I want to dive into a little bit more, which is you were saying the race difference that you notice whenever it comes to those who are either held accountable for paying bail or those that are not held accountable. So specifically, let's just call a thing a thing. Like, how does it affect African-American communities, low-income communities, communities of color, differently than white communities? How is this something that you've either seen through your own personal experiences, maybe through laws that you know of that exist? You kind of hit on this, Eli, hit on that part, Eli. But I just want to know, like, how exactly does it disproportionately affect African Americans and low-income communities?
Do you want to pick or do you want us to just go?
No. Yeah. Now that you guys have introduced yourselves, we'll just have a discussion. So okay. Eli, Atara, Asia, whoever would like to jump in first.
Well,
I know in Massachusetts, sort of statistically, and also I know this goes throughout the country, but
yes.
Massachusetts specifically, Black people are more likely to have higher bails, and same with Latinx people, and they are disproportionately impacted by this, as they are with every terrible thing in the criminal legal system. So bail is no different from policing, arrest, prosecution, conviction, and probation and parole, in that Black people are disproportionately represented in all of those places. And almost universally, everyone we prosecute in our criminal courts are poor. So some percentage in the 90s of people in our criminal courts are entitled to public counsel. They're entitled to a free lawyer. It means that they are making far, far less than we would consider livable. So bail, as every other part of the criminal legal system, is used to corral and control largely Black and brown people, and almost universally people who are poor.
Thanks, Atara, for starting us off. That's great. Eli, did you want to jump in?
Sure, and you know, I echo everything Atara said. I'll just add one more thing. I mean, there is bias that flows throughout our criminal justice system, and you know, you see the disproportionate effects in bail determinations, as you do in sentencing determinations, as you do in charging determinations, like so much else. But the other thing is bail, by its very nature. Disproportionately affects poorer and working class people. The whole idea behind bail is you need to come up with a certain amount of money up front, out of your wallet, out of your bank account, from your friends or your family, in order to buy your freedom. And because of the history and the legacy of racism across so many aspects of American life, what we know is that there is a gigantic wealth disparity that outpaces even the income disparity by race. You know, it's because Black people historically weren't able to buy homes in this country, and housing policies were set up to discourage that. And so you have less accumulation of wealth in Black communities. And so you add bail on top of that, right? And there's no question that it disproportionately affects Black communities and people of color. I mean, the wealth gap, white people on average have 6 times as much wealth as Black people in this country. And not only that, but it's self-reinforcing, because the other thing that bail does is it prevents people from going back to work. The data shows that if you're in jail pre-trial for even 3 days, mm-hmm. and you are poor or working class, you work a shift job, you're more likely than not to lose your job. So it is not only reflective of, but it perpetuates the systemic racism that we've seen in this country by penalizing people because they don't have accumulated wealth, something that we did not allow Black communities to build up in this country. And then basically putting people out of work effectively, you know, before being convicted of anything, forcing them to lose their jobs because they're sitting in jail because they didn't have wealth built up in the first place.
Strong points. Thank you, Eli, for adding that on. Asia, did you want to jump in as well?
There we go. I also wanted to add to everything Atara and Eli said, that, you know, Black and brown people receive bail amounts twice as high as white people. And I have an example of that. I had two clients, both are charged with unarmed robbery. My white client's bond was $500, while my black client's bond was $5,000. And most Americans, four out of 10 Americans cannot even afford a $400 emergency expense. So to go to your family and ask for $5,000 when they can't afford a $400 emergency expense is just not right. And you see the disproportionate of how judges are handing out bails. They were originally supposed to be affordable and to bring people back to court. But who's making the decision as to whether something is affordable or not? Even in your PSI, when they ask you things like, where do you work? How much money do you make? Those things aren't even taken into account when you're at your arraignment and bond is set. So it just really is the corralling of black and brown people in a way to control them, as Atara said.
Anthony, I also wanted to add, mm-hmm. and to add on to what Asia said, which is that the entire idea of buying someone's freedom is a legacy of slavery, right? Like the idea that freedom is something that can be purchased. And if you cannot purchase someone's freedom, then it is okay to keep them in a cage. Is, I think, sort of like a bigger unpacking of the idea of pretrial detention and the idea of bail in and of itself. The legacy of bail is from feudal England and sort of like the history of why we think it's okay to, why we argue around the edges, right? Like we always argue around, like Asia was saying, what does affordable bail mean? And it's used to ensure someone comes to court and it's used to ensure public safety. And none of those things are actually real. And I'm sure we'll talk about that. But just the idea that we accept the premise that it's okay for a money amount to be put on someone's freedom is sort of the larger lens of this discussion. Because otherwise, if you don't look at it through that lens, you start getting into arguments about affordability and what is enough and when is it okay and when it is not okay, right? But you really have to take that view from 1,000 feet and say, actually, the entire premise of this is ridiculous and perpetuates the idea of a class of people where we think it's okay for them to be caged unless they can pay for something.
Wow, my brain is running over here. I don't know about anybody else, but I'm kind of thinking about so many things at once. I want to actually revisit a point, Eli, that you had brought up earlier, which was this idea of like no cash bonds, period, or bails. You know, we just don't want those. So I want to know, what do you think the criteria should be for determining pretrial detention? So we were kind of hitting on this idea that people are being held in jail solely based on accusation. They're not even actually, you know, being charged with anything. So what would this new system look like for pretrial detention rather than cash bail?
Well, you know, we don't have to wonder, and that's in part due to the work of bail funds like Asia and Atara are involved with, and in part due to the work of jurisdictions that have gotten rid of cash bail virtually entirely. You know, I was often asked this question when I was campaigning for prosecutors. They said, what do you mean no cash bail? Like, how are we going to make sure that the community is kept safe? And how are we going to make sure that people show up for trial? And aren't you just going to, you know, rain terror on the community and we're going to have all these criminals running free, right? And mm-hmm. I said, look, are you familiar with a place called Washington, D.C.? Because Washington, D.C. got rid of cash bail 28 years ago. 28 years ago, right? So it's not a recent innovation. And, no. You know, I like to say this. I said the sky hasn't fallen in D.C. The sky has fallen in D.C. for other reasons, but it has nothing to do with bail. But in Washington, D.C., they don't require people to put up money up front in order to secure their freedom. The default position should be that you get to go free. The default position should be a personal recognizance bond, which is basically you are free pending trial with a promise to show up for your court date. And that works for most people. What really works, mm-hmm. by the way, and the real reason people skip court dates, by the way, is not because they don't have a financial incentive to come back. It's because of things like childcare, or people forget their court dates. And this is what what bail funds have been proving across the country, because something like a simple text message to remind you that your court date is tomorrow, or providing for childcare, providing for transportation to court, results in higher appearance rates for trial than if you had a cash bond, but none of that stuff. So we don't have to wonder. Now the question is, so what do you do with people that you think might pose an imminent danger to the community? I recognize that there are some of those people. You got somebody that's engaged in escalating gun violence or something like that. They triple murder or something like that, right?
Okay.
And people ask, well, without cash bail, how are you going to hold them? I say, look, if you pose a serious and imminent threat to the community, really a serious and imminent threat, and we can put facts on paper that identify it, that's fine. I don't want people losing their lives because somebody was let out pre-trial, for example. But when you're arguing for a bail-based system, you are not arguing for that. What you are arguing for is the wealthy serial killer to get out, right? You are saying that your money should determine whether you are let free. My point of view is we need to apply the same standards to everybody. And look, if you pose a real imminent threat to the community, I'm comfortable holding you, right? That's what the community safety dictates. That does not describe the vast, vast, vast majority of people that are in our criminal justice system. They are in there for things like, in Michigan, driving with a suspended license, right? For things like simple drug possession. And they're not being held on $1 million cash bail. They're being held, as Asia mentioned, on $200 cash bail. A bail-based system means that you're comfortable holding somebody in jail for a minor crime on $200, mm-hmm. whereas you're comfortable letting a rich person free that may actually pose a serious danger to the community if they can come up with $500,000 or $1 million and the like. And again, we don't have to wonder about it. DC did it 28 years ago. New Jersey did it in 2017, and you saw crime drop. It is a false choice to say that we need to choose between cash bail and public safety.
Thank you, Eli. Asia, Atara, feel more than free to jump in. Right now, I'm just trying to think about...
I see Asia's hand, so...
Oh, yes. Let me come get her. Asia, you've got the spotlight.
I was going to say, if COVID has taught us anything, it's that we don't need to hold people in jail for cash bail. We've seen jails across the country release people in droves. Not as many as we need to, but we've seen it happen. I had a client whose bond was reduced to $1. Her bond was reduced to $1. And guess what? Her family was too scared to risk getting COVID to come to the jail and pay it. So the Bail Project came and paid the $1 bond for her. And we believe in community release with support. So like Eli said, it's not that clients don't come to court just because they don't care, but it's things like childcare, transportation. We provide lift rides for our clients because we know transportation, especially in the city of Detroit, is really is hard.
Yes.
Not only that, court reminders, even a little text message saying, hey, don't forget, you have court tomorrow. Because the stress of life, work, taking care of your kids, maybe you're in school too. You may forget that you have that warrant out for the driving on the suspended license. So the support of the community and resources are what bring people back to court. It's definitely not money.
I echo what both Asia and Eli said. And I would also, I would add that bail is really a solution without a problem. When people ask the question, what do you do instead? It's predicated on the notion that we have a failure to appear or a public safety problem in this country. Right? So it's predicated on the notion that people are not coming to court in droves and that people who are being prosecuted go out and commit many, many crimes and are public health and public safety problems. And neither of those two things are true, right? So it's never, we always work in the wrong direction. We didn't come up with bail as a solution to a real problem. We have bail and we made up a problem, right? Because we don't actually have a failure to appear problem. I think that one of the studies from New York showed that with nothing, with no court reminders, with no help just nothing, 86% of people to come to court, right? In any other statistical space, you look at that and you say, oh, we're doing fine. We're doing fine, right? 86% success is fine, right? And with those other court reminders, help with court at night, court on the weekends, like court in those times, it can get up to 96, like 93% of people come to court. But that is a very, very tiny margin, right, of improvement for something that isn't a problem. So that's like sort of the first fallacy that you have to encounter when you're talking about the idea that bail is necessary, right? That pretrial detention is necessary in order to ensure one thing, which is someone comes to court. And then with regards to public safety, I can at least speak to Massachusetts, but only 6% of people who are being prosecuted will be rearrested, right? That's just rearrested for anything. And first of all, arrest is not actually a prediction of a person's behavior, it's a prediction of police behavior, right? And so where people who are being prosecuted are already targeted and known, and in a community where police are, that's sort of what you're dealing with in that sense. So 6% of people who are being prosecuted will be arrested while they are out on bail or while they are free pending a trial. That's also not a large number, right? And it's certainly not a large enough number to say that everyone should be subjected to this same system. And then I will always expand this to, we don't just talk about bail in, right? We also talk about all pretrial detention. So part of the issue that we get into when we start talking about fixes is we take bail out of the equation, but we don't take detention out of the equation. And we say, okay, we won't have a cash bail system, but we'll have some other kind of supervisory and detention system. We will try to start doing all of the things that Asia does as a separate organization, and we will try to put it into the court system by saying what we should have, and I will criticize DC a little bit here, which is that we will have a pretrial services agency that's connected to the court, right? Where a part of that equation is, okay, you can go free, but you have to get drug treatment. You have to get a job. You have to do all of these things, but your liberty is still threatened if you fail at those things, which doesn't acknowledge the fact that people who need to get clean or want to get clean or want treatment or want healthcare or want all of those things can't really do that successfully when they have the threat of detention over their head, right? That's not an equation that actually works. Like there's this saying that you can't get well in a cell, you can't prosecute people into health, you can't prosecute them into wealth, you can't prosecute them into wellness, right? And so decoupling that entire idea from the court system itself is part of this solution, is decoupling the idea of healthcare and public safety and housing from the idea of prosecution is actually a way that we address all of these things, not through pretrial detention and supervision, which include bail.
So my brain is really just wrapped around these numbers you were throwing out there, Atara, like the 80% of individuals that still show up to, you know, their court dates without having any type of reminder, you know, no additional resources to be able to help them remember. But yet the one-sided story is as if, you know, 80% of people are not showing up. So I'm interested, like, who is perpetuating this story, and why do you think that they would want, you know, individuals to really think that 80% of people aren't showing up rather than 80% are? I think I know the answer, but I'm just interested as to what.
I think you know the answer. Yeah. I think you know the answer. But, well, first of all, our court system would fall down if everybody insisted on their right to a trial, right? Our court system cannot function if everyone who is being prosecuted insisted on having the trial that they are entitled to. So part of what bail does is it forces people into a corner to take a plea deal that gets them out. And where most people who are being prosecuted are not going to do jail sentences, right? Like the most of the prosecutions that we engage in this country are not serious felonies and not cases for which a long jail term is a possibility or a potentiality. People will take a plea deal to get out for all of the reasons that Eli talked about before, to go home with their family, to get their health care, to take care of their kids, all of the reasons that any of us would take a crappy deal in order to get out of a torture chamber. And so that's a really big part of it. But it's also part of the systemic racism in our entire criminal legal system. And you know, Asia or Eli, if you wanted to chime in.
Yeah, thanks, Atara. That was a good start. Eli and Asia, did you want to add it at all? Like, who's perpetuating, you know, this one-sided story that obviously does not match up with data and statistics for people?
You know, we never look at data in the criminal justice system. We don't. I mean, Atara, I think, mentioned it before. You know, we have a solution in search of a problem with bail, and you know, I love that you mentioned that this is something that we just inherited from literally feudal England, right? But every time we talk about change in the justice system, it's actually looking at whether what we're doing works, we don't look at data, we don't look at metrics. The criminal justice system is one of the most unaccountable parts of society that there is. Instead, what do we look at? We look at isolated anecdotes. It's the Willie Horton effect. And you see this over and over and over again. New York, when New York instituted its bail law, I will say this, I'm not like the president of the United States. I don't get off on attacking the media, but what was on the front pages of the New York Daily News and the New York Post was absolutely shameful, because in a city of 7 or 8 million people, when all the data showed that bail reform was working, they cherry-picked the most isolated and the worst instances, some of which actually happened before bail reform even took effect, right? So these were people that were going out and committing crimes before the new bail law went into existence, and they plastered that on the front page, and you know, politicians got scared. Because, you know, that anecdote sticks in people's heads. You know, I think what we need to do is we need to, number one, shift the narrative in a way that's more informed by the actual numbers and the actual data. But number two, I think that this movement has done a great job of it so far, including, you know, bail funds. But we need to be focusing on the stories at the other end of the spectrum. Because are there going to be some isolated incidents in the criminal justice system in which somebody gets out without bond and then goes out and does something bad? Yes. We have an imperfect society, and human beings are imperfect, and nothing is ever going to be perfect. But think about, you know, the Khalif Browders of the world, right? Who bail literally killed that child for something he probably didn't even do. Not that stealing a backpack should be a death sentence anyway, but bail literally killed him. He committed suicide because he was held in Rikers for 5 years based on bail. We need to be highlighting those stories and that injustice and what our bail system is doing to human beings and to families, and use that to counter these sensationalistic stories that are the exceptions rather than the rule, and distort people's views about what bail actually does and whether bail reform is working.
Thank you, Eli. Asia, did you want to add anything before we transitioned?
I think I just want to elaborate on what Eli said about these are human beings. And part of my new role is to amplify their voices and tell these stories of clients who, while they were released on the bail that we paid, got their GED, got a new job, were successful in an interview, or got custody of their kids, or, you know, these are people who have dreams and people who have goals. And it the narrative that they will get out and commit more crimes, nobody wants to commit crimes. And we don't talk about crimes of poverty or crimes based on addiction that shouldn't be criminalized in the first place. Like, that's a public health crisis. That's not a criminal act that someone should be incarcerated on. And so just boiling it down to the fact that these are people with lives to live. And, you know, he talked about clients who have driving with suspended license. Now you can't drive to work, or you risk getting arrested on your way to work. And so the choices that one is left to make is either, you know, risk getting arrested for something that I shouldn't even be getting arrested for, or continue to live my life. Mm-hmm. And it's just a human component that's missing to all of the narratives that are being perpetuated.
And this is a thing I forgot to say before. I think that everyone on this panel has gotten this question more than once, which is, what do you replace it with, right? And I think part of answering that is to be brave enough to say nothing. You replace it with nothing. right? And then you stand in that decision, because that's the answer. You don't replace bail with anything. And then you work to disempower the system that allows for detention, pretrial to happen. Because what we've seen, especially in places like New York, like New Jersey and DC, and in Massachusetts to some extent, and around the country, is when bail is not an option, prosecutors and judges find other ways to hold people pretrial. Because it's the creep of a system that feels its power in danger, which is we are used to having this amount of control over the population of people that we prosecute. And when you take away any amount of that control, how can we get it back? And so in Massachusetts, we had limited the use of bail to a certain extent. And so our bail numbers are going down. But there's a whole other way that people get held pretrial. There's two other ways generally. It's usually you held without because of some kind of danger situation, like you're perceived to be a threat, or the thing that you're prosecuted for is a particular kind of charge that's perceived to be threatening. And so you can get held without bail. I know Michigan has a statute that's similar, and there are a lot of those kinds of statutes around the country. And then the other way people get held is on a violation of probation. So someone is free, their case is over, they're on probation in some kind of way, and someone has alleged, has accused them of violating their probation. Mm-hmm. So they can be held on that. And Khalif was actually held on a violation of probation. So he was not releasable on bail after a certain period of time. He was held pretrial for something else, like for another reason where bail would not have set him free, right? And so when we get into this discussion of pretrial detention and supervision, we have to use this idea of bail as an entry point, not an end point, right? Mm-hmm. Bail is the entry point into the system of pretrial detention that we have. And it's pretty easy to understand, right? Because money gets you free. But then there are all sorts of other reasons why people aren't free and they have not been convicted of something. It's not just bail. And so I think we have to be brave enough, because it's only the starting point, to say you don't replace it with anything. You do nothing. You let people go free. And then we can start moving into the sort of more complicated and heavier reasons why people are held pretrial, where it's not as easy to get them out.
Don't replace it with anything. Wow. That's so powerful. I was writing that down in all capitals. I was like, this is genius. So before we dive into our last question right now, thanks, Atara, for sharing that, Eli and Asia as well. We're about to go into our last question, participants. If you are in the chat right now and you are eager to ask questions like me, I would love to ask, you know, some of my personal questions, but we've got one more to do. Please hold on to those questions. And about the next 5 minutes, we are going to transition into that QA time. So let's end here, Atara. So you just said, let's replace bail with nothing. So let's say that we get to the point to where for bail reform, we do that. As a country, we decide no more bail. That's it. We're not doing it anymore. What do you guys think logically is the next step towards ending mass incarceration, specifically for people of color and for individuals from low-income communities? Because we all know that bail is just one part of this big moving ecosystem that we know disproportionately impacts people. So if bail was not anything that we were worrying about anymore because it didn't exist, what is the next thing that we should collectively go after in order to really just start to chip away at mass incarceration?
I believe in divesting. If we're divesting from the cash bail system, then that means that we are investing in our communities. Part of the money that funnels through the court system is 10% bonds. On a 10% bond, if the client goes through to disposition, they only get 90% of their money back. And the courts keep that 10%. And so instead of that money being kept by the courts, we take all of the money that was made off cash bail and we invested in healing spaces, educating the public on restorative justice practices. We are creating addiction rehabs. We just got a partnership with one of the nicest rehabs in Washtenaw County, and we will be sending clients to Dawn Farm. And I think that if we invest in our clients, and let's not even use the word clients, because we will no longer be when cash bail reform exists. Mm-hmm. investing in people and what they need in their education, if in their goals. And so if we invest in the communities, I don't think people will be incarcerated at the rapid rates. And also, I'm an abolitionist at heart, so I don't believe anybody should be in a cage under any circumstances. But actually getting to the root of what is causing incarceration in the first place. If we're criminalizing addiction, then let's get to the root of why people are using drugs in the first place. Let's not criminalize those people. Let's treat those people. Let's talk about why people are stealing, because they don't have jobs, because they don't have money. Let's talk about that. Let's not talk about incarcerating everyone for everything.
I mean, Asia, you just said it. Like, you know, it's a, and you said the magic word that I've been like walking around this whole night, which is, you work towards abolition, which is destructive and creative. Yes. So at the same time as we're attacking this system. So we do cash bail. Yes. Okay, now let's do probation violations. Now let's do probation. Let's do parole. Let's do disproportionate policing. Let's do all of those things. But also let's build, right? Let's build the world that we want to see, so that we don't use police, prosecutors, or prisons to address social and harms, right? And so what do we do? That means taking money, right? That means taking the Massachusetts Bail Fund has spent over $2 million in Massachusetts just getting people free. Imagine what we could have done with that money if it didn't have, it wasn't robbed out of communities that way, right? Like Eli said it at the beginning here, like the disproportionate impact on poor and low income, especially black and brown counties, is robbery. That is robbing money out of that system and either just holding it so it does nothing or actually using it to fund the system that's torturing people. And imagine if we could wrest some of that away and give it back to community, right? Like we have places where people aren't prosecuted in those same ways. Every community should look like that. And so at the same time as we're sort of chipping away, we're also building. And by building, we're also building power, because we're not just building housing or healthcare or community engagement or all of that. We're also building a powerful community that has the background and backbone to stand up and fight for the safety and health of their own spaces, right? And so it's not just a build and destroy, it's like also a power building situation. And that's, I think, the thing that I've seen that's most powerful over the past 5 or 6 years, and the way that this conversation has shifted enormously from being afraid of people who are incarcerated to being led by people who are incarcerated and who are led by those voices, you know? And so it's, I think we lose all the time, right? There are places where we fight and we still lose, but what we have at the end of it is more power, because we have more knowledge than we did before. And I've watched that happen over time. And I think that that's the direction we're going in.
Let's go. Power is knowledge. I love it. Eli, did you want to add anything on to that before we transition into our Q&A session?
Boy, it's tough for me to say it better. I will just than Asia and Atara did. I will just say one thing.
Yes.
Whenever we talk about investing in communities, whenever we talk about investing in education, in housing, in community development, you know, the question is, well, how are you going to pay for that? How are you going to pay for that? And I'll just say, we are paying for it in droves at the back end. What we know about the relationship between, you know, housing insecurity or third grade reading levels or high school graduation rates and the likelihood of future incarceration is that those are very pronounced relationships. So it's not a question about whether we're paying for it. We are paying for our failures right now through our system of mass incarceration, which, you know, costs a lot of money, but it also imposes a severe human cost. I think what the shifting of resources really is about is, you know, not paying for something new. It's just a question of whether we're going to pay for or when we're going to pay for something. We can pay for it at the back end, like we've been doing with our system of mass incarceration for decades in this country, or we can actually invest in people at the front end, which means that we are going to be safer in the long term, we're going to be healthier in the longer term, and we are going to be more vibrant in the long term.
A common, you know, trend that I noticed amongst all of your answers is just this piece of going back to the human side of it, and how by removing the human, you know, behind this system, it makes it easier to perpetuate this system. So I'm hearing exactly what you all are saying, and I would love to ask questions on my own, but right now I promised everyone else that we would go to a quick Q&A session. So right now I want to actually provide us with the next 10 to 15 minutes. We are going to now transition into our questions in the chat. So if you have any questions for our panelists regarding tonight's discussion, maybe something they said, a question more about what they do within their city for bail reform, please share it at this time. So I'm seeing a question right now that's popping up in the chat. I'll read it for us, and then any three of you are able to respond. It says, how can we be agents of change? Are there resources for initiatives, small or big, that we can actually take on in order to be part of the solution?
This is something I learned at the very beginning of this, which is look around and see who in your community is already doing the work. Because it's not a one-size-fits-all situation, right? And I'll use an example as like California. California bails are astronomical. They're regularly in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. So people hear that I run a bail fund and they are saying, oh, should I have a bail fund in my community? And I would say, well, do you know anybody in your community who needs to be bailed? Do you know anybody in your community who needs that, where that is an issue for them? And then look at how bail works in your space. Right, in California, it wouldn't make sense to have a bail fund because a bail fund couldn't be funded high enough for it to make a difference in California because the bails are so high. So really look around and see who's already doing the work, and also pay attention to who's leading the work. And using the litmus test of nothing about us without us, make sure that the people who are leading the work are the people who are impacted by the issue. To look around to see where you want to plug in and where you want to hook in, because it might be an issue that you weren't aware of that actually is a really huge one. Very big one in Massachusetts right now is no-cost jail calls, right? It's not actually bail. It's actually getting no-cost calls for people who are incarcerated so they can make free phone calls to their families, which is even more important now in COVID. And that just might not be something that you thought of as being so extremely important to families. But by paying attention to what's happening already, you can find the places to plug in.
Atara, before we jump over to the two other panelists, I wanted to kind of dig into a part of your response a little bit more. You keep on going back to this idea that those who are the ones that are impacted are the ones who should lead. Why is this so important that those who are, you know, the ones that are at the receiving end of this system are the ones who are actually leading and advocating for that change? And maybe someone who wants to be a part of that solution but isn't directly impacted is more of a listener and more of somebody who is in a supportive role.
Well, I think because historically they're always left out of the room. I can't tell you the amount of government rooms and the amount of stakeholder rooms I've been in, which is all the same person. And it's never a person who has experience being held without bail, fear being held with bail, or ever paying a bail, right? It's never those people who are in those rooms who are making those choices and making those decisions on what it is that they want and what they actually need to feel safe. We always hear from people who talk about safety and community safety, and it's never from inside the community that supposedly they are trying to keep safe. So, you know, and it has been historically a hard lesson for me to learn as a defense attorney coming in, right? Which is like, I thought that I was helping. And then you have to just, okay, instead I'm listening, you know? So I will take that and sort of kick it back to Asia and Eli to see if you have something to say about that.
Such a powerful point. Thanks for going in a little bit more on that. Eli and Asia, any suggestions on how we can be better agents and advocates for change?
I'm going to take it back to the bare bones and voting for local offices, like your prosecutor.
Let's go.
That's very important. I didn't know how important that was until Eli came and met with us at the office. And I'm like, wow, prosecutors have so much power. They're the ones who are in charge of charging, what people are being charged with, sentencing, whether or not they're gonna place a bail amount on someone. Like, all of this is in the powerful prosecutor's hands. And so voting for someone who aligns with your beliefs, if you don't believe in cash bail, try to find someone who also wants to abolish cash bail. And if you don't, like, be that person. Be that person. If you look around, like Atara was saying, you look around and you see a void, then you should stand up and you should be that person for that issue. But usually there is an impacted person who you can talk to, who can guide you, but also amplify that person's voice, because those are the voices who are so often silenced. And I have found, with being an impacted person, that no one can talk about that experience of sitting in a jail cell. No one can. People can say, oh, I can empathize with you. I can imagine what that must have felt like. But no one can imagine what it's like in those dark, lonely moments when you're sitting in a jail cell and a pandemic is happening and you can't get a mask and you're sitting on jail because you don't have $250 and the officers don't want to come near you because of COVID. Like, this is a this is such a tragedy, especially right now that we're holding people because of poverty.
Thank you, Asia.
So I again echo everything that Asia and Atara said, especially about needing to listen and letting the people that are impacted lead. And I also, obviously, given that I just went through this, I would say yes, voting is very important.
Yes.
Beyond voting, though, run for this office. And I'll tell you, I never in a million years, I you know, you heard my whole background. You didn't hear a single thing about me being a prosecutor, because I'm not a prosecutor. The first day I'm going to be a prosecutor is when I take the oath of office as the elected prosecutor. And I never in a million years thought that I would be running for prosecutor, except that we've seen over the last 5 years, people from civil rights, from criminal defense backgrounds, running for these DAs and prosecutor positions and winning, and even when they don't win, really changing the conversation in communities across the country. So, but I'll say this, there's a small group of prosecutors and elected prosecutors that control, they're taking the sort of reins here and are moving it in a more decarceral direction. There are 1,200 prosecutors, elected prosecutors, I think, across the country. And in the aftermath of George Floyd's murder, 40 of them signed a letter condemning George Floyd's murder. 40 out of 1,200. When you saw a man murdered on tape, and even Mitt Romney was out in Black Lives Matter marches, right? Mm. So that should tell you something about the mindset of prosecutors, and it is important to get people in these offices across the country. And I guarantee you, I mean, we saw a lot of people, across the country here. I guarantee you, except for the one person from Ann Arbor, I'll leave you out of this, but you're probably better than whoever was elected. You may be better than me anyway, Valerie, but honestly, there are, I don't want to call them awful people, but there are people that are doing awful things in prosecutors' offices across the country. If you believe in ending mass incarceration in any way, shape, or form, think about running for these positions. Or if you're, you know, if you're not a lawyer and you don't feel like you should be at a lawyer job, find somebody to run. If you get these issues out here, people agree with them if we actually start talking about them. And even if you don't win, like, you know, Tiffany Caban ran an incredible race out in Queens and lost by like 80 votes for DA in the fourth biggest district attorney's office in the country. But she changed not just the conversation in Queens, but the national narrative by running the most bold and decarceral platform, I think, for a DA's race that I've ever seen. Getting these issues in front of the public makes a real difference in the political sphere, because for far too long this happened behind closed doors and in the darkness. And when people hear about it, they're on our side.
Can I add with voting that it isn't enough actually to vote? You have to stay once the vote happens. As a person who posts bail in a county where there is a so-called reform prosecutor, and we're posting just as many bails as we ever posted before, it's not enough to elect someone who has good rhetoric. It is, and I would be remiss because I'm to not mention this, Eli, because I'm on this with you, but a prosecutor, any elected official is only as good as the promises that they keep, not the promises that they make, right? And so it's the aftermath that is the most important, because anybody can say anything, you know? And that's definitely what we're seeing in a lot of these spaces. It is very hard for someone who is elected to walk into an office and give up power, and that's essentially what we're asking them to do. We're asking a prosecutor, anyone, to go walk into elected office and do less. And that is really hard for people to wrap their mind around when they're in an office and all of the DAs who work, all of the assistant DAs who work for them don't want to do the thing that their boss wants them to do. So vote, obviously, everybody, and also stick around afterwards. Yes. And then if you are a person who has been elected, you have to hold yourself accountable to people. People can't hold you accountable. You have to offer yourself to them, right? You can't hold anybody accountable. I can hold myself out for accountability to somebody, right? Where I'm willing to listen to you and I'm willing to hear what you have to say. And so that's what I would ask of our elected DAs and our elected officials, which is hold yourself out to the community who voted for you and do the change that you said that you would. But there's also a lot of other stuff besides that, which is organizing and power building, but we talked about all that.
Y'all, you heard it here first. Don't just vote, run. You got me thinking over here. I'm like, what do I want to run for? Thank you guys so much. I want to actually hit on this question real quick because it was a good point. We didn't talk about this in advance, but we were talking earlier about pre-trial detention. Asia, can you actually just share with us what exactly is pre-trial detention? And then the follow-up question for that is there a cap on how long someone can be held, even if they're not accused, just held on bail?
So pretrial detention describes people who are sitting in jail or even on electronic monitoring, having been convicted of nothing. They've been charged with something, but they have not been convicted of a crime, of that particular crime yet. It varies from like jurisdiction to jurisdiction as to how long you can be held, but I'm not sure. Eli, you might know the answer to this.
There's no limit.
Atara, there's no limit to how long you can be held pretrial.
You all said before that there was someone that was held pretrial for 4 years?
In New York, on Rikers Island.
Yeah. We posted bail for somebody who'd been held for 5 years. Your bail order stands until your case resolves. So until your case resolves, then the bail exists. And if you can't pay it, then we call it like you're doing a pretrial sentence, right? That's what's happening. So Asia's exactly right. I would agree with you, Asia.
And a lot of our clients I've seen, they will, like Atara said, like they will take a plea to get out of the jail, even if they didn't do it, even if they've been overcharged, even if this is gonna be a felony, this is gonna follow them for the rest of their life. They will take a plea so that they can leave that hellhole.
Keep going. Oh, I just wanted to add on to that. I mean, you hear about wrongful convictions all the time, but yes, the majority of wrongful convictions are not, you know, a jury decided something based on faulty evidence or whatever. The majority of wrongful convictions are because somebody admitted to a crime that they didn't do. And that seems so foreign to most people. Why would you say you did it if you didn't actually do it, right? And they sort of just intuitively don't believe the wrongful confessions exist. Mm-hmm. But think about the desperation of somebody being held in jail, away from their job, away from their family. That leads to more wrongful convictions than, by a long shot, than anything else in this country.
And we see shows like Law and Order and other shows like that where decisions are made in the courtroom with the jury. Less than 10% of all court cases actually go to a jury trial. So these decisions are being made in back rooms between prosecutor and defense attorney, or going to the client and saying, listen, you've been sitting here for 7 months and we're gonna give you an out today. You plead guilty to this and you can go home today. And who, after you've been sitting in jail for so long, you've lost so much, all you wanna do is go home, take a shower and sit with your family.
Thank you for hitting on that some more. And actually, this, you guys kind of touched on this a little bit before, but it says, are there any parameters that determine a bail amount, or is the amount arbitrarily determined by the judge? How are bail amounts determined? I think it was Asia or Atara, you were talking about how you had clients who were different races that got wildly different bail amounts. How does that happen? How is that possible?
There are statutory guidelines in every state, right? So there have been, you may have heard, there have been a number of pretty high profile bail cases over the past couple of years attacking bail schedules. So that's sort of like an Excel spreadsheet of charge and then cost, right? So if you're charged with this charge, then your bail is automatically this amount of money. Those have been ruled largely unconstitutional. So what you end up with are criteria that judges can consider from the law when coming up with bail. And every state is different, but it's largely, the similarities are basically a judge can consider the safety of the community and whether you're gonna come to court. And there are usually outlined, 5 to 15 criteria that they can consider. What ends up happening, and Asia alluded to this when she talked about the prosecutor before, is you're arrested, you're brought in front of a judge, or you're accused, you're brought in front of a judge. You get to talk to a defense attorney for 5 minutes if you're lucky. And an argument gets made in front of a judge about what your conditions of release should be. So the DA goes first, right? The prosecutor goes first and says, this is the amount of money that this person should have to pay, and these are all of the reasons. And the reasons usually consist of the police report. Here is the police report that I'm going to read to you. Here is the person's court record that I'm going to tell you. And then the defense attorney can get up and make a counter argument. This, the person's bail should be XYZ things, because this is a human and who lives in a community and who has kids and who has a job and is a person and should be free. And you can see how those two arguments actually don't match up, right? Like the recitation of an accusation and someone's criminal record or someone's court record doesn't actually match up to the ability to be like, this is a person who lives in this world and who lives in this community, and they should be able to go home. But then the judge makes the decision. And the judge makes the choice, balancing those two arguments, looking at the law as the outline, and then makes that decision. And that's pretty universal across the board.
I want to thank you all so much for engaging so fully in our discussion tonight. Thank you for being present. Thank you for just sharing your knowledge and bringing your expertise to the table. I can't speak on behalf of anyone else on this call, but I know as the moderator, I've learned so much, and I'm so grateful to you all. So virtual round of applause. Thank you, guys. Thank you to Atara, Eli, and Asia. Right now, this does, in fact, conclude our discussion for tonight. We'd like to thank you all for attending tonight's virtual discussion on bail reform. We encourage you, we talked about this already tonight, but if you have not already registered to vote for the upcoming November election, I just sent in the chat, the NAACP has on their website resources for you to access to, number one, check if you're registered to vote, number two, register if you're not, and then number three, see where you are allowed to vote at. So please, please, please check that out in the chat right now. Otherwise, thank you so much. Right now, I'm about to play us off of our call this evening with a little bit of Michael Jackson, Man in the Mirror. If you'd like to dance and hang out with me, stay here. Otherwise, we'll see you next time. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Asia, Eli, it was very nice to meet you, and it was nice to meet all of you.
You too. Thank you for having us.
Oh, of
course. This was great.
Gonna feel real good. It's gonna make a difference. Gonna make you right.